My topic today is flight to economic moksha. We all know what is personal moksha, to come out of the cycle of constant birth and rebirth and achieve everlasting bliss. I'm of the view that a far greater role is to create a fair and judicious society which offers us the energy of all, and so I call that societal moksha. And today we will talk about economic moksha and what happens. Let's consider that there is an epidemic going on. What will happen if there is a medical epidemic going on? Usually, health professionals will use what is called horizontal factors to solve it and vertical factors. Horizontal factors are clean water, clean air, nutrition. Vertical factors are immunization, medication, healthcare. Any of that? Now what happens is that if you ignore horizontal factors and keep dumping more medicines, it sometimes doesn't change the needle. And this is where we as India have reached today. We have any number of vertical programs, ye tax kar do, ye kar do, wo kar do. One is announced every week, so I'm not going to get into that. But who has touched horizontal factors, because the time to play at the margins is gone. I will take up with you three topics today that I think have fundamentally finished their shelf life in the way we manage our economy. Number one, banking. Number two, technology. And number three, governance systems. There are 100 topics. This is a complex topic, but in 12, 15 minutes, this is the, I thought, the three best to pick up. We are having repeated economic cycles that are causing anguish, like an unending chakravyuh. A certain character is needed. Today your banking loss is 10 lakh crores. Now what is the sense of a constitution which has socialism in its preamble, where 150 people are given 10 lakh crores? This money is not coming back. This money helped save the first recession, but it came at the cost of denying the daily entrepreneur, middling guys like me. So we shifted from development banking, which was for everybody, to commercial banking, which in fact became steel banking. And now we are in honest no banking. Now, had we gone after this problem in time, with sensitivity, what's your problem? Are you in a mismatch situation or in a robbing situation? We would have solved and re-energized the system. Because episodic blasts, they last 10 years, but they are solvable. But we ignored them for 6 years, and today we are going after them with machine guns, and there is nothing left to pick up. So net, you have a demoralized decision-making system, nobody lending, the middle entrepreneur not being able to play the financial game, and a systemic collapse. In this systemic collapse, you can put any number of ointments, and it's, you give me a shock like that, I'll also feel like good for 20 meters, but ultimately I have to run on my own 500 meters. Pretty tough. I come to technology. I'm going to tickle your mind. What is accounting for our biggest current account deficit? Oil. I just give you random examples that you are familiar with. I don't want to make it a Keynesian theory of economics, neither I'm competent. I'm a practitioner. The ways to solve oil dependence are many, alternate energy, improving engines, we do all that. But the single biggest thing to solve, to improve the current account deficit, is to improve the productivity of oil itself. Any disagreement with this? Now, California adds 15% to their oil. We add less than 2%. addition, the motivation to create from maize ethanol, change the agricultural landscape, to go in for science for catalytic materials, these type of things are now going to solve your problem. 4 rupees here, 2 rupees here, 60 paisa here is not going to solve your problem. It will help. Let's take car industry. The chairman of the most cost-effective, biggest car company makes a public statement and we all keep quiet. He says, you know, India is a $2,000 per capita country. Why are they asking for safety systems in their car, which countries with $30,000-$50,000 per capita ask? And we absorb it. I mean, you Indian, you're not fit to get safety systems. Is he selling his car to the 2,000 per capita Indian? You have a technology problem. If you had, the fundamental issue is you're tired of that product. The world doesn't want that product. With your cost base of under $10,000 per car, you should have been the biggest exporter in the world, and many countries with this cost base are the biggest exporters, but you're not. So you have a fundamental problem of technology that has run its course. All of you, many of you are IT czars, some of you will join the IT industry. 20 years ago, every newspaper used to write how India is becoming the tech capital of the world, taking away jobs all over the world, right or wrong? Yeah. Anyone seen such an editorial in the last 10 years? Because startup companies in the last 10 years, not one, two, 50 of them, individually are worth more than your entire sector. Now, unfortunately, very derogatorily, they say, calling the Indians. Again, it's a value addition technology issue. If you want to kickstart an economy, Saridon, I'm carrying 103 people, how long will Saridon help? So my simple message to you is that you and I have to take charge. You actually have to believe that you and I have to take charge, because the only ones are affected are you and me. To take charge, you have to jump out of the box, and to jump out of the box, you have to recognize that you're in a weak box. You have to recognize that no vertical program now is going to help you, and I come to the third, and the third is governance systems. 10% of India, whether in a PSU or central government, state government, panchayat, department, unknown and unknown, are employed by the government. The only instruction given to them when they get recruited is don't get caught. Is it morally correct that 90% of India should be on a day-to-day job, and these 10 people for an exam they passed at 23 should be in a permanent job? And thus you have. And then get a pension. I'm not getting into corruption and all that stuff. You know, in Germany, where you physically pay for your pension, if you take another job post-retirement, your pension gets cut, even though you have physically paid for it. Here, the pension is add-on. All this is costing you 3 to 4% of your GDP. Only its excess is enough to wrangle your economy. Now you add other factors. You have the worst time and cost overrun in the world. We are a very rich nation. Everything that is made everywhere for 100 is made here at 500. Everything that is made everywhere in 3 years is made in 20. We have a constitutional problem that says that the bureaucracy is the steel frame of India, which means you and I, the citizen, enter India via the bureaucracy. You and I are the steel frame of India. Our energy is producing what it is producing. We've got to fundamentally think how we can dismantle these structures, and why in brilliant companies, you can have professional management structures where people come and go. This can't happen in government. All the HR tools, all the programs, all exist. Finally, I also speak English best. We have to ask ourselves the ethical question that we have 0.03% of world trade. Korea, China, Japan, Germany, they all know English to internationalize. But they don't have to learn English to take a leadership position or a good position in their own country. We are keeping a very large percentage of Indians out and their energy out of the game. Nothing against English. English can continue. But don't think English gives you exports. You can depreciate your rupee from 70. In 1947, your dollar was 3 or 4 bucks. Today it's 70. You were 0.03% then, you're 0.3% now. Because your ambition cannot be to sell a $1 t-shirt. Because if you depreciate the rupee to 70, to 100, we are all poorer in dollar terms. We are all making ourselves easier to buy for somebody with a dollar, and we are all making it harder for us to buy their assets. You are making your petrol higher, you are making your defense higher, all to sell a $1 t-shirt. Why don't you brand, get into technology and go into a $6 t-shirt? T-shirts are sold for, on an average, 4.5 to 200. Don't get into 200, but don't think small. And the young in India, 600 million under the age of 25, can't be guided by this 58-year-old defensive thinking, waiting for a pre-retirement sinecure. Or can he? You guys are the smartest kids in the world. There is no need to make you more poor than you are. You are capable of tremendous value add. The best brought up children are Indian children. The energy parents put in them. What little failing is that pro-life skills are not there in our education curriculum. We are taught rote learning. It's a serious problem. We'll discuss it another day. Broadly, I'll tell you, in London, New York, Bombay, to get a taxi license, you have to pass a test where you have to know 90% of the roads of the city. Today, does an Uber driver need to know that? So gets it digitally. So your rote learning is now useless, right? So we don't know how much the world will change, and it will change very dramatically. So the whole thinking process has to go towards pro-life skills. And for this, another obsolescent way of thinking, that public duty lies in supporting third-rate public sector units. Public duty lies in supporting health and education. Ladies and gentlemen, in the 4 minutes, 23 seconds left, I have pretty much covered all that I have to. Thank you for being such a lovely audience. I really want you to think big. I really want you to think out of the box. And I really want you to understand the value of these horizontal factors, because the demographic dividend that is going to come from those in front of me will not come if you are not energized in the direction you must take. I wish you from every corner of my heart the greatest joys, and don't spare yourself. You have great potential. Thank you.